Hepburn from two delegates, Delegate Sewell and Delegate Guzman. They wanted to have their bills passed by for the day.
So moved. Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? This bill is passed by for the day. We'll go ahead and take Delegate Van Valkenburg. You want to go ahead and do the first one? You want to do it from there? Whatever's most comfortable.
You do either place. I'll be right here.
Okay. Whatever's most comfortable.
Whatever's good for you.
All right, we have House Bill 1116 before us. House Bill 1116.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is a bill that deals with voter registration in schools. So I'm just going to real quickly talk to the intent and then to the practical impact. So the intent is, you know, schools, public schools, one of their core missions is to promote engaged citizenry. And one of the ways of doing that is not just to teach civics or government, right? But to actively promote it, whether it's volunteering or participating in a democratic election or whatever it may be. And so this bill seeks to, especially as we move into the new accreditation standards, which are important for graduate and citizenship in there, kind of try to tie what we learn in the classroom and in the community, right, to actively participating, whether it's through a nonprofit or in this case, you know, providing access to voter registration. And to kind of give a personal example, you know, I typically provide access to students in the spring as we're moving into the primary season. You know, our year's over, they've won lessons, they're excited about these upcoming Virginia elections. And it provides a way to kind of tie what we've taught to what's actually happening in Virginia. As to practical intent, I want to emphasize that this is a really low bar. This is just about providing access to students. You know, the minimum, and I hope schools do more than the minimum, but the minimum is that they're providing access online to the registration link or just providing paper copies to students who don't have driver's license, who can't do it online. It is not meant to be onerous, it's not meant to be like, hey, congratulations, you're 18, here's your voter packet. It's not meant to, you know, it's not meant to require, it's just to provide access and to have somebody at the school who's in charge of that process. So, you know, I think this is a great way, especially moving forward with these new academic standards to really create an engaged and active system.
Questions from the committee?
Thank you. Is there anything that prohibits schools from doing this now?
It's a good question. The answer is no, they don't. A lot of schools don't do it. And I think when we're talking about engagements, when we're talking about what can make government and what can make civics more real to students in the classroom, the way to do that is to really bring it to participating in your local and state government. And I think this is something that schools should do, something that a lot of kids say, hey, I never got an opportunity to do that. And so I think it's an important piece to education.
Any other questions from the committee? Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to speak in favor or against the bill?
Madam Chairman, Tom Lynn, President of the Virginia Electoral Board Association and Secretary of the Virginia County Electoral Board, I'd like to speak in favor. I realize that many high schools already provide this kind of service, but I am distressed. There are some high schools that do not. So they're very much in favor. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in the audience?
Madam Chair, I'm Mr. Hague. I'm Jay Weisberg. I'm the voter registrar of Brattle County. I just want to say that oftentimes we did, we claim that we have 135 jurisdictions out there that aren't working together, we have different policies everywhere. This is really not a large financial commitment by any means of resources. But I don't know why we would want to make sure that every Fairfax County, let's say, Arlington County, Charlottesville City, voter is registered, but that people in Giles County, or Lee County, or Scott County, their principals there, you know, say, might not even bring it up. So I think that, you know, in light of the fact that most of the time we try to seek uniformity across the state, and this is an egregious public policy, I think this is a good policy for young people to get registered as soon as possible. Madam Chairman, I regret that I missed the first vote that I was eligible to vote for when I was 18 years old. It wasn't something that came to my attention, but I had good records since then. But I missed the first one, I regret it all, you know. Can't go back and change that, so I would hope that we would have the same policy across the Commonwealth. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So that's why I think we should defeat the motion.
Chairman, speaking of the motion again, I don't have any problem with what you're trying to do. I think it's obviously a good idea that 18-year-olds and people eligible to register to vote do so. I think the question is whether or not we need to impose a mandate on every school division and institution of higher learning, and you know, the Commonwealth. You know, I don't think we need to do that, and for that reason, I support the motion. Thanks, bye. Thank you.
Okay, we're not opening up the vote now, this is recorded, but all those in favor, please vote. Okay, next bill, we'll take up, Dalvin Bell.
I'm here.
Dalvin Bell, we have House Bill 268.
Morning.
268, thank you, Dalvin Bell.
Morning, Don, Scorpion, yeah. House Bill 268 actually is seeking to put in a better system so we can avoid some of the misunderstandings on ballots that are received in elections. I'm a retired military officer, and a number of times during my career, I voted absentee when I was overseas. One time I did it when I was in the desert, and frankly, I walked through about 2 miles of the desert to get to the tent where I could affix the postage and send off my ballot. And it disturbs me whenever, for whatever reason, absentee ballots are counted, because I always believe a lot of those are military people who are serving around the world, often in harm's way, and they go out of their way to vote. And I think we can do everything we can to make sure those ballots are counted. One of the things the Postal Service offers is called the Intelligent Mail Barcode. In Virginia, if you actually print out your absentee ballot, it's already printed on the return envelope. It's just some of our localities are not using it. It's free of charge. And as a matter of fact, you can go and there's no software required to use the Vera system supplied by Virginia. And with that barcode that's on there, it would actually supply near real-time tracking where that ballot is all the way from the moment it's sent until it's received with an exact stamp of when it's received at the post office. So then, basically, we can eliminate confusion of whether a ballot is received on account at the actual postal facility, not the postmark, but when it's actually received. I don't believe counting military ballots is something any of us want to do. We want to count it. And I also don't believe that that's a partisan issue. Frankly, I think our military votes should count for whoever votes, regardless of how they vote. And I believe this just adds another tool to timestamp when ballots are received, to get rid of some of the confusion that occurred this year so we know when votes are received. And it's a great system, it's available, it doesn't cost us any money. That's what this bill does, so I'll be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Questions, okay.
So we're talking about tracks of when the post office came, that will say when the post office received it, local jurisdiction.
That is correct. When,
or in the sorting system.
No, it's actually scanned and tracked all the way through from the moment it hits the system, wherever the military member sent it, all the way, you can track me and show where it's at in progress. And it shows when it's received at an actual postal facility, where it had been left on the location.
Yeah, question, counsel. The, my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, is the code, doesn't deal with when a ballot was delivered to the post office, but when it's delivered to the registrar's office. Is that correct?
That is correct.
I'm just gonna ask, why do you go down these avenues? What's the rationale behind that?
Frankly, I don't have a good answer to that, because I think it would take some pressure off of the registrar. I get the last question, you know, delivered to the actual registrar, but in many cases, the registrar is gonna keep not picking things up. This would show what was there, what wasn't there at the postal facility that came up. Some of the localities are just not familiar with this system that's available. And frankly, some thought it would cost them money. It doesn't cost any money, which makes me believe in their responses, they would cost money. They just didn't understand the system was available. And I think it's a great tool to help registrars and actually take pressure off of them. And I think registrars do the best they can, and they do a good job. They're honest people. And sometimes, you know, people like conspiracy theories, and they will blame folks for things that aren't true. I think this would help to clear their good names and to prevent those kind of questions. So I think it's just because people don't know what's out there.
Just in reading some of my paperwork, it says that Fairfax County currently uses a barcode on one of their envelopes. Is that correct?
I'm not from Fairfax County, but I believe that Fairfax, the larger counties, do use the barcode system already. Some don't.
So it's sort of permanent.
It is. And I'm sure I got the commission of government actually did a. Some of the localities submitted fiscal impacts. And some, again, this leads to what I was saying before about misunderstandings. Someone thought there was a cost for it, and it's correctly free of charge, which leads me to believe they're not using it because they just didn't understand that. Many didn't say anything. They are already using the system.
Any questions?
Good morning, Madam Chairman and committee members. I'm Chris Watkins, the registrar from Lewis County. And I support the idea behind this, but as this bill is written, I oppose it because we use the intelligent mail barcode on outgoing ballots. This past November, we sent 13 ballots to a nursing home facility in our county that had a PO box. We sent them all together on the same day. Five of them were never received, but the barcode tracking indicated that they were received. And the reason that we followed up on it with the Postal Service, and they told us that the scanning is done at the distribution center. And so if a voter had sent those ballots back to me, I would never have convinced them that I did not receive them, even though it said they were received. So we used it on outgoing, and we did see some issues with it. So until this system can be tweaked a bit, I can't support the intelligent mail barcode as we have it today. Thank you.
Ms. Kinney, can you see that for a question?
Sorry. Ma'am, can you go back?
Did you have a question?
Down at Sickles?
Yeah,
yeah. Down at Sickles.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So, can you educate me on a solution to that being not mailing 13 ballots in one package? Why did you mail each voter an individual?
They weren't mailed individually. They were mailed 13 ballots on the same day to the same address. They all 13 had an individual barcode on them. And so we could track them. So when the facility called me and said, we don't have ballots for these people, And I had my certificate of mailing as required by law to show that I did mail them. And then I went into the system to use, to check it out on the ballot scout to see where the ballots might be. It showed that they were delivered. And that's what made me get more involved with the postal service to see what happened with them. And we spent a lot of time with folks in Richmond trying to find these ballots and ended up having to go down there and reissue the ballots. So we were able to correct the problem, but we to this day don't know what happened to those ballots, even though the ballot tracker said they were delivered.
Sure. So could you tell us what the solution would be to fix that problem? I think you did it in your first statement.
Well, according to the post office, they said short of the postman that's taking it and delivering it to the person having a scanner there, that they wouldn't be able to track it.
That's why I asked that question. Anecdotally, both of my sons were in Iraq last year. And when I would send them mail, the postal carrier asked if I wanted it to be tracked. I said, well, what does that do? He said, it's really not much. He said, it will tell you when you got to the country, but it doesn't. It only happens at the facility where they have the big machines that do the barcodes. It's not like FedEx, which I was driving for 12 years. And when you scan, when you deliver it, you put in the name. It's not like that. So I think we're using FedEx with those. So, and it's just through volumes. If you're going to deliver a billion letters, you're not going to be able to hand scan it. And so Bill, that's why I asked that question.
Any other questions for me? Okay, thank you.
Anyone else in the audience?
Position brings up an issue and say, this doesn't make sense, and you pause and stop and think about it, and it does, it, it is in fact something that I think is just an inadvertent situation that we have. The reason I brought this bill is, I'll explain to you about that in a second, the reason why I brought this bill is that a constituent sent me a note, a pretty nice note after the election, saying, I missed a chance to vote, because when I showed up to vote in person in absentee, because she was going to be out of town, knowing that she was going to be out of town, she came with a passport, her driver's license, her voter ID card, everything, and the registrar said, oh, but by the way, you also have to put down the actual digital of your social security in this card. And she said, what for? I said, well, it's required by law. She said, well, I'm trying to prove my identity, I've got my ID, my photo, everything. I won't give my last four digits because I've been a victim of identity theft. I'm kind of paraphrasing her saying here, but she basically said, I've been a victim of identity theft. Why do I need to give you my social security when I'm actually here? You can prove that I'm here with my driver's license and all. And the officer at the Fairfax County Government Center said, sorry, I'm just complying with the state law. And the state law says you must prove that the last four digits happened. And even though I can verify your identity in all the other forms, I still need those last four numbers. She refused to give it. They refused to let it vote. And so she walked out and she was very mad. So she sent me a very nasty note. Bottom line is, when you look at the code sections, I'm not sure, numbers, it does say on 957 of my bill, that's the existing code, it says the applicant's printed name, the passport, et cetera, that should be provided or applied for an absentee. So what we would say is, in the event that you are voting in person, absentee, knowing that you have an excuse for being out of town, that last four digits should not be required, because everything else is still required in terms of voter ID and everything else. So it's a way to alleviate the concerns of some folks out there that don't want to be on their last four digits for any reasons other than being tax purposes. And to the extent that I know over the last few years I've been down here, we're seeing a trend of trying to not require social security numbers to be disclosed in public documents. I think this makes sense. And I really do think this is just an inadvertent way that we've done this, because it presents on the state as a problem. So that's what the bill does. If you have to answer questions, my constituent can come down this morning because of the time they've done. And their statements are very unique.
Well, I wish I had your energy.
I don't see much. Questions
for the table?
No question.
Another way to try to prove that the person who is saying that he or she is voting is that person. So I think this section is stated in the book the whole time without ever being questioned as a reliable form. So I'm not saying it's not a reliable form, but what I'm saying is that for this very narrow circumstance where a person walks in front of the registrar or the judges and says, I'm here to vote, here's my card, here's all my information, I have my photo ID, and on top of all that, you still need to put four numbers in about, I can tell you the numbers, but you have to write it down, that's when they're concerned. Social security number is on the card, it's on the government documents, on the field, based on high needs and others, that just is not a necessary thing. So I don't think there's any, I'm not trying to undo something that's been done in the past. I think this is a very narrow circumstance where it just really doesn't make sense. And where, at least in my case, there's at least one person I know who was not on the vote because she refused to give out something that she thought was too much personal information that would need to have been in staff. So, I mean, I don't think that this is something that whoever drafted in the past said, this is the only way for us to prove that we must be the same for the rest of the time that we have this closed session. But I can't answer any more detail than that.
Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to speak in favor or in opposition to this bill? Sorry, please support.
Thank you, good morning. Phil Majelski, I'm from the station of Pelican Keen. I have been personally subject to then that questions because of my status as a federal employee, held online, all my information, the top secret clearance has been stolen. So the sensitivity that we have around federal contracting and particularly in the Northern Virginia area is one that's very legitimate. And so the matter that the Pelican Keen presents is one that's real. And anything that is X as a barrier to someone stepping up, being able to exercise a franchise should not be a factor. Thank you.
Thank you. Another question?
Thank you.
Go ahead and count it without coming back the next day or 5 Monday or whatever it is.
this is the, we would take sort of the advice of the registrar as I read the language. It says the electoral board to determine the validity of the ballot.
I mean, that's true of all provincial ballots. It's the electorate, it's up to the electoral board. Certainly the registrar is advising them, but it's the electoral board that actually has the authority.
We might seek advice from the GIS people, other people in the county, the adjoining county, to find out exactly what the situation was before we decided which ballot to set.
Any other questions for Kate? Anyone else in the audience who's to speak this morning?
Chair, before we vote on the bill, I'm wanting to say that we've got a bill on the other subcommittee that if we pass, hopefully we'll make this a new point that you know ahead of time. That everybody for sure what the super in, that's what I'm gonna do.
How was you last? Okay, we'll move on motions.
Move report, second.
Okay, we have second to report on House Bill 1325. And on the vote. Thank you, Valdez, Cole. Okay. Delegate Adams. We have House Bill 1496. Thank you for your patience. I'm sorry, it's a bit here. House Bill 1496.
Good morning, I'm Chairman, members of the committee. Before you is House Bill 1496, and this bill seeks to increase accessibility to photo ID. One of the things that I have learned to appreciate now that I didn't like as a kid so much is being told how I'm wrong by my father. And one of the conversations that we had was around voter ID and this idea of voter suppression versus voter fraud. And the law of our state is that we will have photo ID. And so to that end, you know, this bill addresses some issues that we have because there are difficulties getting this voter ID, which is already in the language of in our code. You know, we have about roughly between 300,000 and 600,000 people who are not getting their photo ID due to lack of access. These steps have been identified in the literature review. And but what we know is that photo ID is a free part of our Virginia code. It's something that's accessible to all people. It's just a matter of really finding that and accessing that. I have six of us with different educational backgrounds go and look for how would you get your voter ID. And each one of us initially landed on the DMV website. On the DMV website, what you'll find there is a section that says ID cards. And then when you go through the ID card, you'll see that there is a long process and it costs between $2 and $15 a year. The State Board of Election site, however, which is a little more difficult to find, has an application for that free photo ID. What this bill seeks to do is increase awareness by putting this on the website of DMV that there is a free voter ID with information, provide education, as well as provide an additional outlet, or 77 additional outlets, where people can get their photo ID. Now, having been a state employee, one of the things I would also try to take into account is that that could Christina should really be a standard bearer for how we do this process, how we balance these concerns about voter suppression and voter fraud, and recognizing that it is a duty, a right, and a responsibility. I believe that this bill will help us achieve that objective.
Questions for the committee? Another question.
Do you have the required numbers for the data license plate issue?
I do not. Thank you.
As a citizen of Richmond and a member of the League of Women Voters, I support this bill. Thank you. Thank you. They go through the current vendor that the State Board of Election currently uses, and I think that the fiscal impact is less. Madam Chair, my understanding is the Department of Elections currently centrally processes those voter ID cards. We're not involved in that process, so we probably get better information from elections or the registrars. But when speaking with Delegate Adams, one of the options we discussed was the idea of using the existing process the Department of Elections has, which would lessen the cost of DMV. But we have not discussed that with the Department of Elections.
doesn't take away from the registrar's office, it just provides 77 additional open houses.
Just to clarify, you can get a photo ID that can be now. It's not a driver's license.
Correct.
You can go and get one right now, and that's the way a lot of people will get their photo ID if you don't drive to vote. And you can also get it at the Department of Elections.
Yes, it's just that these two IDs are different, have different burdens of proof, and one is free and one costs.
So the DMV that we can pay.
DMV makes you pay. It's also a little more labor intensive to get that photo ID.
Any other questions for the patron? Anyone in the audience wish to speak on the bill? No questions?
Madam Chairman, I'm back in my economics training, and I think I believe that free is always better than something that costs money. That reason, and again, it looks like we're solution certain problems. So that reason, I'd like to make a motion to be the EI.
Okay, we have a motion to table the EI. Is there a second? Okay, we have a second PBI House Bill 1496 that is available. Do you want to speak?
Madam Chair.
Delegate Sipos.
This is bill is not the biggest bill in the world, but allows more people more convenience. We'll be down on the side of making government more convenient, doing more people, and that passes all this does. And I cannot believe we're going to kill this little bill.
Thank you, Delegate Sipos.
So that next year will we have 425 I agree with Blake, which is an excellent idea. It should be much more viable. At the time, the cost and not knowing which system we're going to use, it's a little early, but next year, with success on the other fronts, we'll probably have more success.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Madam Chair.
Dr. Fowler.
I've been to DMV many times, and I've been to my registrar's